But if you'd like to stand up, because I'm going to pretend, because I... Yeah, I got the mic. But no, he's going to turn the mic off. He's told me he would. All right, here we go.
Oh, Lord, my God, when I, in awesome wonder, consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed.
Consider turning off your phones in case you get a phone call. Although people don't tend to ring now, they just email or whatever, or text. So just as kind of an introduction of myself, some of you might have heard the story, but I'm going to bring it up anyway. Just before I do that, I just wanted to say too, and to get it out there, that this is all about Nancy, of course. We all know that. But you can't talk about Nancy without talking about Basil. So Basil is going to come up in it. So we just have to accept that, because Nancy and Basil were two. And just on that, because Nancy was the quiet one, I'm sure you realise, and Basil, well, he was the social one, wasn't he? So anyway, but you never dismiss the quiet ones. That's for sure. They have, yeah. So my introduction was I had met Thao in Dunedin, and we were coming up, so this was 40 years ago, that's around 20 somewhere. So Thao's dad, so Basil, had said to Thao, don't ever bring a boy home with long hair. So So she brought four boys home. There were four of us travelling in the car with her and my dog. It was in a F.B. Holden, by the way, anyone that's keen on Holdens, in 1960. Had the Union Jack taped on the front. It was a very cool car. It wasn't mine, it was one of the other guys. But the point of the story was that, so we came into the house, and it was back on the farm. And, oh, well, I mentioned the farm. Anyone that doesn't realise it, there's the it's that new highway out of Normanby. If you look straight ahead, there's the Clements big tree there. So back in those days, so Clements were on the left, and the Mortlock's farm was on the right. And you can't miss it, that tree's still there, which is a great thing. But coming back to this, so we arrived at Bauer's parents' place, Basil and Nancy's, and we were sitting in the lounge. And my first introduction to Basil was he came in and said, "Who owns that dog?" And I kind of said, "Oh, me, you know, it's my dog." It was a Kelpie, his name was Hash. Well, and then Basil said, "Well, he's just killed one of Mum's chickens." So that was the first words, you know, this future son-in-law, that was my first words. Anyway, I have to say they were very gracious. They put up with us. It was some years later, actually, Val was talking to Nancy, and I think they're talking about broken marriages and things. And Val asked Nancy, and she said, "Well, what chances did you give Chris and I of sticking it out?" And Nancy's words, roughly from what I can understand, was, "Yes, well, there's that." And you can tell, you know, they didn't give us a lot of chance. But they were gracious. They were gracious. And they, you know, they were very, always interested. I felt they were always interested in us and what we're doing and you know, got involved with us. It's a great thing. So that's cool. So I want to read Nancy's words now. So she had this box made. Can't stand away from the microphone. Anyway, so I'll just read her words. They found this letter in the box. I've had this box made to hold my ashes and placed beside Basil at the cemetery in Hara. It includes my little treasures that I've collected over the years, and it was made from the footboard of our oak bed, that we shared for 61 years. And now we will be together again. It's been nearly 5 years since I have been on my own, and we are getting really ready to celebrate Janet's 60th birthday. This was in October 2014. So now you can work out Janet's age. But isn't that a great thing? So it was made. So Nancy had it made from the footboard of the bed, you know, the oak bed. Oh, and that's really special. And even more than that, because I gather that Ron Mortlock, so Basil's brother, made the bed in the first place. So it's quite significant. It's quite neat. So that's cool. So that kind of leads me on to, there's lots of little details that have happened. You'll see the pictures here and the photos up the top, up on the, it's actually a mirror. So Basil made the mirror stand too, you know. And so lots of little details, you wouldn't perhaps realise it, but the sisters and that and the brothers have been pulling a lot of detail together into this. There's lots of little details like you got the Scotch thistle. Well, there's Nancy had the Scottish background, but also she was always very good at finding weeds and pulling them out. So it's kind of significant. That's good. All right, and then of course there's the tartan colours around the place. So one other detail, they had to limit numbers here because of the whole COVID thing. So if you see someone that didn't know about it, or someone you might meet someone in the street, you could just explain that there had to be a limit of numbers. That's all good. All right, so that was all I want to do just there. So then what we'd like to go on to now is the speakers. So it would be Murray, you'll see that the names there, Murray, Graham and Harley. So perhaps if you'd like to come up as you want to, you might want to come up together, but please yourself. So where's Murray gone? Oh, here, yeah, sorry. Perhaps if you come up first, that'd be great. That's it.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Mari, just in... why I'm clarifying that is I went to see Mum one day, and when I took her into the dining room, the lady, other lady at the table said, "Oh, are you two twins?" I wasn't overly impressed. And then I went to visit her another day, and... The resident was sitting in the foyer, and she said, "Oh, good, hello. I think I've just seen someone like you here." Anyway, so I'd like to say especially our thoughts with Richard and Shannon, Sienna, Haven and Rebel in Boise, Idaho, and to Regan, Ali, Aidan, Harper and Ella Sorensen in Portland, Oregon. Richard's a brewer, just in case you don't know. So, and also I would like to just acknowledge the Alexander cousins that couldn't be here. Rex and Marion, Ian and Michelle, Graham and Donald and Gay, is it? I hope I got the right name. I did ask and probably forgot. and Carol Burke, who was Jim Alexander's daughter, and their family, and also Audrey Wingate and her family. I'd just like to acknowledge that they would love to have been here, but not able to. So I'd just like to share some influences that Mum has been to me in my life. One of the first things, that Mum was always there. She was always available. I always knew. If she wasn't right there, I always knew where she was. I can remember one time coming home from school, and she wasn't there, so I went through her wardrobe to see what clothes on to find out where she was. Anyway, so some of the things that Mum used to say that shaped my life, she used to say, Grandpa Alexander used to say, if you keep your shoes clean and your mind clean, you'll go a long way. And she sent us to Sunday school to learn the Lord's Prayer and the Ten Commandments and that God created the earth and all that is in it. And she bought me a Bible when I was 9. And Mum always said, when you were doing the washing, hang up the trousers by the waist so the wind can go through it and they will dry better like that. And in the 50s and 60s, we didn't have spin dryers to get all the water out. So it did take a lot longer to dry the clothes. And you put the peg on the clothes, so when you take them off, the peg mark won't be seen. So she didn't like it if you had a peg mark in the middle of your garment. And then she said, also, after you've had a shower or a bath, stand in the shower or the bath and drip dry there, not on the floor in the bathroom, because then someone's got a lot of cleaning up to do. She's quite wise, because, you know, there was 6 of us. It's a lot of work if we don't do all these things. I remember some family coming one day, and it was just on lunchtime, and so Mum saw them. She said, just go and get another knife and fork and plate and put it on the table and shuffle all around, and you know, we all had to share what was offered. And so I learnt that hospitality at the table was, you're always welcome, and you were always welcome in our home. Finally, oh no, this is not quite final, when I was 17, and I was all knowledgeable, as 17-year-olds are. They know everything in the earth. I was having a debate with Mum over the Church of England, and which is the Anglican Church and its formation. And she said to me, well, I don't know too much about that. But she said, it is 1,966 years since the birth of Christ. And I couldn't argue with that. And it is now 2,020 years AD. AD stands for the year Jesus was born. And I'm sure there's other things that Mum has said that has shaped my life, but these are the ones that I think, the most formative in my life. Finally, I would just really, really, really love to thank the Annie Bryden staff for the wonderful care they took of our mother and the wonderful care of me when I visited, and also my other sisters. And in her last days, and you know, all this pandemic stuff, when I went to see Barb, she said, "Now you tell your family to take their masks off when they go in to see your mum. She's to have a proper kiss and a proper cuddle." And it was just so lovely. Thank you, Annie Bryden.
Right, I didn't really know that I was on the program today, but there you go. So we'll talk about my mum, grandma, great-grandma, cousin, friend. Nancy was born in 26, at Hara, and she was the second daughter of Jack and Maggie Alexander that lived on the Grand Road here at Tarwitty, just down the hill. And she went to primary school at Tarwitty and on to high school at the Hara Technical High School of those days. And at 16, she left there and she worked for a year for a Mr. Fison that was an accountant. And Nancy was very good at doing bookwork. She was very meticulous where you put the cents, would have been the pounds, the pennies, the shillings and the pounds, and all that thing. And after she had been there a year, she went into hospital to have the appendicitis operation. And while she was in hospital, her father decided that her working days at Fison's were over. And he went into Mr. Fison and told him that Nancy would not be coming back to work because he had a job for Nancy at home on the farm. And Nancy went home and her and Dorothy milked about 40 cows and some of the farm work and all that sort of thing. And then there was these social events, and it was the local dances. And there was a particular dance hall at Tarwitty that was seen to be quite popular with all the young bucks of the district. And young Basil went there and he scored himself a prize. And what I would say about Nancy is that she was the ideal girl for Basil. Very compliant, not very argumentative, and just got on with it. But I'm afraid she couldn't make a decision. And quite often she'd be asked the question, "What do you think of this?" And she would say, "I suppose." What does that mean? Yes? What does it mean? No. And they were married for 61 years. And all I can say is that I would have liked to have seen the time that Nancy said to Basil, "Yeah, well, I know you want to go and do such and such, but I'm busy doing such and such. If you want to go off and do it, way you go, I'm staying home." But no, she just dropped whatever she was doing, put her best hat on, got in the car, and away she went. Now, my memories of my mum. She was a great mum. And the things that she did for us kids is, I remember we all had a calf at Calf Club. And who would make up, get the sack, and make the calf club? Well, like every school calf had to have a calf cover. I don't know why it did. And the other thing I remember was the jersey that she used to knit us. And I will admit that there was one day there, it wasn't that I seen red with her, is that she had produced me four sisters. And I had enough of sisters. Why the hell would a man want a sister? And along came another one. Four bloody sisters. I can remember telling my father that my mother was dumb. Why did she give me a sister when all I wanted was a brother? Well, Mum went back and had another go.
Just for you.
Well, poor old Trev, he's here. Well, I found him not the usual ornaments of the evil, but never mind, he's still my brother and I'm proud of it. And there's always a meal there. And what I miss about Mum is the cauliflower pickle and the tomato relish. And that will stay in our minds forever. And she will be the best Mum, grandma, great-grandma that we can ever have wished for.
Yeah. Well, hello, my name is Harley Ogle and I belong to Nick and Linda Ogle, and this was my grandma, best grandma in the world you could hope for. Got some notes here. It was a pleasure to go to my grandparents' house. It was like a big holiday, and when it came to Grandma, Granddad was always the prankster, so if we got pranked too much, she'd let you in on it a little bit, so you could have a bit of an easier day, because there were cups of waters and boxes on the doors and you name it. So, yeah, she evened the playing field out a little bit for us, except for when it came to playing cards, which Jim Rummy was their favourite game, they taught us all. And Grandma is quite a good cheat at cards. When you are 10, you learnt the lesson that, yes, the elderly people can do one over you. You just didn't think it was legal. So, I do remember one day, too, that they bought a Mitsubishi Sigma. That's the first car I'd seen with electric windows compared to our wind-ups. And Granddad got that out of the car, and my finger had to go on that button, up and down, up and down. And Grandma just turned around slowly and said, "Do you think that's enough, Harley?" But no, I was thinking, "Oh, I want to push it one more time." But she's like, "Granddad's getting back in the car soon." And I do remember being naughty one day, and she smacked me too. So I probably deserved it. And she was a keen gardener, and she one of her houses she had the cactuses along her shelf there, and so she plucked one off, and there must have been like 8 goes for us to get one to grow for me. So had that for quite a while until it, no longer anymore. Granddad wasn't the only builder. If you went to the house with a problem and wanted something done, I had a fishing rod, and I love surf casting, and my biggest problem was getting it all down the cliffs to go fishing. So I went to Grandma and she said, I'll make you up a bag. So she made this long bag and had a end on it, you tie a knot and put all your fishing rods and poles in it, and quite a few trips up to Coromandel, and my mates are all climbing down the bank and their bits are going everywhere, and I just smiled because Grandma had helped me out, and yes, that was great. So she was very good at things like that. Another good thing that my grandparents did is I'm a dairy farmer, and I have my first 3 dairy farming jobs and more. They would always come and turn up within the first month of me being there, and Grandma would come out with a box of chocolates or a bowl of fizzy, and very keen to meet your boss. So that made your day when your family turned up when you're in a place that you were new at. Other than that, I guess you're all family or you're all friends of Grandma. It's a pleasure to see you all here, and if I don't know you, you can introduce yourself to me later on. Thank you so much.
So now we're just going to do this photo, whatever you call it, presentation. Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming, everybody. That's really lovely. Mum would have really enjoyed it. She just loved being with you all. So
As I said before, I'm Valerie, and I'm the baby daughter. I have a baby brother as well, but it's quite interesting. When I went to visit Mum at Brighton Court, she introduced me a couple of times. One, I was, this is Valerie, my sister. And another time, this is Shirley, my daughter. So Shirley was her sister. Anyway, myself, I quite like a good funeral because you hear the impact of one life on others. And, you know, I think that's the purpose of parents, is to have a great impact on your children and set them up for a great future. Mum's inspiration on me was faithfulness and dedication. It's always about family first. Nana and Grandma were very much a part of their lives, and they looked after them. Mum and Dad looked after them very well. Apart from Mum's involvement in CWI, of which she was a member for nearly 70 years, Mum had very few interests outside the family. She just loved helping us with our car club, as how we talked about that, you know, our school lambs and our school calves, and she taught us all to cook, and so I'm sure she taught the boys how to cook as well. But, you know, the girls, they all made their own wedding dresses and bridesmaids' dresses. That's how well Mum taught us to sew. I wore Mum's dress when I got married. I didn't make one. But, you know, between 1954 and 1976, those 22 years, I estimate Mum made about 26,000 school lunches. And not to mention girdle scones and copious amounts of pie clips. And, you know, haymaker's meals and like Mary said, our dinner table was always a welcome plate. Mum was a lady that was very content in herself. Well, if she wasn't, she never ever let on. Except once, I think, when we were all squabbling at the table. It was the only time I can ever remember my mother raising her voice, and she stood up, she put her hands on the table and said, "Shut up! Shut up, the lot of you!" I was like, Dad nearly fell off his chair, and everybody was like, "Oh, quick, quick." But that was the only time I can ever remember Mum raising a voice. One other time is, well, she didn't raise a voice, it was her hand. We'd built this amazing hut in Haiti, and Trev had just got a new pair of glasses, and we lost the glasses. And the Clemmy boys were there, and we were sent back down to that hay shed to find those glasses. We never found them. All of us got a tanning. She lined us all up. But Mum's contentment of the simpler things in life is something I've come to appreciate. I didn't so much at the time, but Mum loved nothing better than doing a crossword in a sunny spot, weeding the garden, having a nice cuppa with family and friends. In fact, it wasn't really until Grandma Alexander died and Mum that Mum took an interest outside the family, and she took up croquet, and she loved croquet. I watched her play one day, it was awesome. Of course, Dad didn't like it because all the ladies were shh. But Mum loved it because it was a game of strategy, and she didn't have to talk a lot, which was Mum. As Howie alluded to, or Graham, and Mum had a brilliant mathematical mind, which Michelle got, good on you, mate, because no one for the rest of us, why sure as hell didn't, you know. Mum loved learning. I have to tell you, she came up to Auckland, and that's a real sign that they loved you, you know, because Auckland was just a foreign land to Dad, and he hated it, and I understand. But I had a fax machine, and Jan had just bought the florist shop in New Plymouth, and Mum said to me, "Oh, you've got a fax machine." And Dad said, "Oh, quick, send Janet a fax." So we wrote out this fax, stuck it in the machine, Mum punched the buttons and put in the paper and went off to Jack. Anyway, paper comes back out and I must have handed it to him and he goes, "Oh, he didn't send that at all. Look, the words are still on the paper." So funny. But yeah, Mum loved, you know, she loved to add up a column of numbers, loved it. You know, she'd always help us with our tax returns when we were working, you know, single and working. She loved that, and she would always know how much change she could get on a purchase. I remember Dad bought her a calculator in the 70s, and she was quite miffed. Like, why would I need this? She actually could add up quicker than the calculator. About Christmas 2000, I mentioned to Mum, "How would you like to go to Scotland?" I always wanted to take Mum initially to the islands because it seemed a bit more doable, but she was not interested. And then one day I said to her, "How about I take you to Scotland?" And I said, "Well," and her face just lit up, and I said, "Well, if you do, Mum, you have to get fitter because we'll have to do some walking. And we'll have to pull our bags, so you need to get a wheelie bag." Well, Mum was out the gate, and she was walking, around and getting herself really fit. So in August 2001, we met Jane in London, and Jane was the best navigator ever, and we drove through London. I picked up the car, drove through London, and we drove all the way up to Drumley, you know, up through Stirling, up through Drumley Drocket, up the top of Scotland, well, not quite the top of Scotland. And Mum had her 75th birthday in her grandfather's grandparents' kitchen on the Webster Farm in Inverurie. It was just wonderful, really good. Another funny thing, we went to the Edinburgh Zoo too. That was part of going. Unfortunately, Mum dozed off. And I could only get in on the later showing, you know. And so that was at Edinburgh Castle. It was really good, really good. But I just patted Mum on her knee, and I said to her when we were landing in Heathrow, I said, "Mum, when we're here, you stick with me like glue." I said, "I don't care," because we met with Auntie Shirley and Auntie June as well. And I said, "You just make sure you stick with me, Mum, wherever we go." And I'm really amazed, actually, that Dad trusted me to take her. It was great. But we'd gone out for dinner with Jane and David. We actually successfully got back to London. And we were out for dinner, and David said to Mum, "Oh, Mum, you know, Grandma, you're in the theatre district here. How would you like to go to a show?" And Mum said, "Oh, what do you mean?" And they said, "Well, you know, it's the London Theatre, and you could go to the Phantom of the Opera, Mamma Mia, the Lion King." And Mum thought for a minute, and she said, "Oh, I know. I'm all right. They all come to Harborough." But that was Mum. She just loved the simple things. Thank you, Mum, for living in New Brighton. But she soon became a resident, the resident darling. That day, Isabella was absolutely, absolutely amazing. She just held Mum's hand. I couldn't handle it, but she was so good, Isabella. Thank you, darling. She became Brighton Court resident darling, and I really thank you, John and Steve, for coming today, because seriously, they were so good, so, so good to Mum. And Mum just loved them, and whenever, you know, we would go and see Mum, she'd be, "Oh," and when the nursing staff would come and she'd say, "Oh." But, you know, she got really involved in the life and activities there. And often, you know, she'd go out on a bus trip and she'd often buy them all an ice cream because she's nice and generous like that. So, I do, like Mary said, I do want to thank Riding Court staff. Chris's mum was in rest home care, and seriously, you guys are top of the top, just amazing. But I also really want to extend my thanks in particular to Mary, Linda and Janet. You've been amazing at looking up for mum. And, you know, the grandkids as well, you know, you'd often take your children in to see mum. Now, I know it's not easy going into those places, even though Bryden Court was fabulous, but I'm so grateful that you would do that, because mum, you meant everything to mum. You were her everything, you're all. And thank you to my family. You just, you know, that each and every one of you just meant so much to mum. Mum would have really enjoyed being here today, because she would have been with you. And I hope that for those of you that can, you'd like to join us at the cemetery to unite mum with Dad, that would be great. And we'll just, thank you.
Very good. Well done, Pat. That's great. Val just mentioned, if you'd like to join us at the Hara Cemetery. So that's, so we're going to leave here about 2:30. So it's still, and we assemble at the Gladstone Road entrance, by the way. Walk in from there. That'd be great. So I just wanted to read, there was two other nephews that couldn't make it. So this one's from Richard, so Mary's son. Sorry, what did I say? Son. Oh, did I? Nephew. Oh. Into the picky with the details. That's great, isn't it? He's related in a way. that's good. So this is Richard. So he said, to my grandmother, I'm sitting on the other side of the world right now, wishing I could be with my family and friends, saying our goodbyes together as we send you off to be with Granddad. Grandma, you are an amazing person with some much love for us grandchildren. You always remembered our birthdays and spoiled us at Christmas. You always cared about our future and made sure we had a little something put away for a rainy day. You were a generous lady and spoiled us on our 21st birthday. Thank you, Grandma, for your love, generosity and life advice you have passed to me. Our visiting and having holidays with you and Granddad was one of many highlights of my life and made my childhood years bearable. I struggled a lot as a kid, trying to figure out how to make my way through life. You and Granddad were a huge anchor and a solid rock in my life. You gave me life tools and advice that has got me through life with success. For this, I'm forever grateful. I love you, Grandma, and I will miss you. So to my mum, Tom and Bev, I'm sorry I cannot be with you today to say goodbye to Grandma together. I'm thinking of you and the whole family at this time. I love you guys and look forward to talking to you soon. P.S. Give Mum lots of hugs. She loves hugs. And then to my whole, this is still Richard, to my whole family, I love you all and miss you dearly. I have Shannon, Sienna, Haven and Rebel here with me, and we are all wishing we could be with you today. Please forgive me for being a dork and living so far away from you all. That's his words. lots of love and hugs. So he's in Boise, Idaho. So then there's Regan, which is not the nephew of Janet, the son of Janet. So Mark's brother. So he wrote, I'll always remember the holidays as a kid, going to grandma's and granddad's, being given so much attention and spoiled with love, playing cards, eating oats with brown sugar. I guess he means porridge, huh? And of course, the time on the farm. I miss my grandparents, but I'll always have great stories to speak of them. Always loved Regan. So no, that's great. And see, Regan mentioned playing cards, and Harley mentioned playing cards. I'm sure I didn't. Harley mentioned he spotted Nancy cheating, but I never saw her cheating. But I'm convinced that she lost a game of. I can't remember a game of cards, but I'm sure she deliberately lost so that Basil would win. I think she was very strategic like that. She was smart. They were saying there's a difference between being right and happy. It's probably right. But no, that's good. All right, so that's all good. So the notices were there about the Hara Cemetery at the back. So that brings us to the end. We'd just like to finish with the Lord's Prayer. So if you'd just like to stand up, and the words are up there, if you'd just like to follow through with the... Let's pray it through. So, here we go. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive others who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. That was Nancy's kind of favourite prayer. So there's an afternoon tea now. They'll be bringing it out. So please feel free to stay around and chat and join. And we'll join you at the cemetery, whoever wants to be there. That'd be great. Thank you all for coming, and thank you for honouring Nancy. It's been a real special moment. That's great. Thank you.
One glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away.